Welcome, everybody. We're going to wait for a few minutes for people to enter the room. We'll probably get started at like 12:01 or 2. So just hang tight and thanks for being here. We're going to get started in just a few seconds. Oh, that's 12:02. We're going to get started right now. Awesome. So thanks so much for being here, everybody. My name is Brittany Vandewerf. I'm the Communication and Outreach Specialist for New Mexico EPSCoR, which is the established program to stimulate competitive research. It's NSF funded and it's nationwide. I'll be your host for today's webinar, along with Isis Cerna, our website administrator, who will be working behind the scenes to do everything to make it flow smoothly. A few housekeeping things before we begin. I want to let you know that if you have questions at any point, feel free to type them in the Q&A box and Isis will politely interrupt our presenter and ask him the questions. And if it's something that is time relevant, feel free to ask at any point during this webinar. I know he really wants to make this a useful training for everybody. So with that, I would like to introduce our presenter for today, Mr. Rusty Nail, who has been on the New Mexico Smart Grid Center team for a while now. He's a graduate research assistant at NMSU under Dr. Olga Lavrova, and he received his BS in electrical engineering from the University of New Mexico in Albuquerque in 2019. He's currently pursuing an MS degree in power systems with a certificate in public utility regulation and economics at NMSU. And his research interests are electric energy systems, including renewable energy integration and electric vehicles. Thanks so much for being here today, Rusty, and take it away.
Hi, everybody. I'm going to go to sharing my screen here. Thank you for the introduction, Brittany. As she said, my name is Rusty. I'll be giving today's beginner webinar. And I'm over at New Mexico State University right now. So first I want to jump into starting with what is OPAL-RT? And let me get to the slideshow here. So put simply, or OPAL-RT's description on their website is this long-worded and winded language here. Put simply, it's computational hardware and software that allows us to run fast simulations. And that allows us to be capable of running simulations that are also capable with interacting with real world components, and that it's designated as hardware in the loop simulations. It looks a lot like this. There's several hardware instruments you can purchase or buy from OPAL-RT. One of these is the OPAL 5600, and we have one of these in our lab. There's a newer version of this that is the OPAL 5700, and that's what we'll be running, but it looks very similar to this. And essentially, it's a bunch of FPGAs and some CPUs that help you expedite whatever code you may be running. And there's various types of softwares that can be purchased or used. There's HyperSim, ePhaser Sim, eFPGA Sim, and eMegaSim. Those are all proprietary and have varying costs, but today we'll be using a version of eMegaSim, which is RT-LAB. And I'll be getting into that later, but the reason why we're using that today is because it couples with MATLAB Simulink. And so most of the actual programming and whatnot is used from MATLAB Simulink, and then it essentially gets plugged into RT-LAB, which allows us to communicate with the hardware you see on the right. So what is MATLAB Simulink? So in case you haven't used MATLAB Simulink in the past, here's an image of what it would look like. It's a drag and drop graphical programming environment designed by MATLAB, and it's a way for you to be able to simulate, test, and debug multiple control systems, schemes, and all those other things. And so what we wanna do is oftentimes you'll make a model like this in MATLAB Simulink, and you'd like to speed it up, or you'd like to incorporate real world components. So you'd like to send a signal from the simulation you have here out to OPAL, for example, and then that signal will actually interact with a relay or some type of communications device. It'll send also a real-world physical digital analog signal, which you can incorporate back into your simulation and have real-world behavior rather than just these equations and theory and stuff like that. You can actually incorporate some real-world testing before you integrate it into an actual grid. And those are the kind of applications we're looking at. Well, how does this work? Where does Simulink, how do we plug this in and get it to work with RT-LAB? Well, first you take that Simulink model, and I'll go through the process. We're going to make a simple one later. You would make this Simulink model, and you're going to package it into a subsystem called SM underscore file name. And that SM subsystem essentially stands for main computation system. You're packaging your Simulink model into something that's digestible to load onto the OPAL-RT, and that's what it's going to be using. Do we have any questions? I see there's three chats. Oh, okay. Never mind. I was just checking out on that.
Nope, you're good.
And so
no questions yet, Rusty, but I did put the link to the research document in the chat.
Great. Okay, cool. So as an aside, once you've made this single subsystem, there's then a second subsystem that you need to create in Simulink. And again, I'll walk you through this, but just to preface, you'll know what we're looking for later. And this subsystem is the GUI subsystem. This is actually what you'll interact with once you load the Simulink files onto RT-LAB with OPAL-RT. And that system is going to be called the SC system. And this stands for the CPU system with respect to the desktop you're working on. More of this will make sense later. But essentially, you have what's loaded onto OPAL on the left and what you see when OPAL's running on the right. And then you can also make this a control loop, where things that you interact with while OPAL's running in real time on the right end up affecting the simulation and the main computation that's going on the left. And this can become much more complicated. We won't get into a system like this today, but this opens the door for other cores available on the OPAL-RT that also allow for parallel processing and things of that nature. And those are called SS systems. And those are just subsystems that help in the computation system. So now I'm gonna walk you through making a simple example. It's gonna be, I was going for a two node, but I wanted to mix it up a little bit. So we'll have a source here, a simple electrical circuit. We'll have a source, we'll then have a switch, and then we'll have two resistors. So going into that, I'm gonna open up MATLAB just as I would. Again, we're gonna start with Simulink. I'll close everything else. So here I have Simulink, where I clicked on this to open it. And then what will come up is here. We're just gonna make a blank model. I'm gonna show you from scratch, making a simple two node model, how we'd get this started. Okay, so I'll open it up. And first thing I wanna do, again, it's drag and drop. How you're gonna get most of these components is by going to the library browser. And the first thing we wanna make sure is that we have the libraries we need. So you're gonna need to make sure you have RT-LAB and RT events. These will be libraries that you get when you purchase OPAL-RT software or download RT-LAB, I believe for free. You'll get these libraries, and sometimes they won't show up. There's debugging processes for that, but you want to make sure you have these. And then the last one you want to have, at least if you're working with power systems and things of that nature, is going to be the specialized power systems, and that's what we'll be using today. So I'm going to go to the library that I'd like to use. We're going to go to, we'll click around, and I'm searching for sources here. Okay, so we're going to use an AC voltage source. Drag and drop. May take a minute. Okay, awesome. And you can really organize this how you like. See, it'll say AC voltage source. If we go back to that last image I showed, I called this VS. That's relatively standard. Could just be V, could be V1. I'm going to call it VS. And so you can actually just go in and change the name. What's nice about Simulink is you can generally annotate anywhere. You could on older models, it looks different, but I'm using the 2019B version right now, and you can just double click and start typing away. And sometimes they have commands that'll automatically drop down, but that's just kind of an aside. Okay, so for this voltage source, the next thing I'll need is a ground. So I'm gonna look for that. Okay, I got a ground here. And again, there are multiple grounds, but that's why it's kind of important to either search the full document, but or look for it on your own, but make sure that when you're looking for components, they'll only work with other components in that library. So there are other grounds within MATLAB Simulink, but they're not grounds from the electrical library. And so they won't be compatible with each other. So just keep that in mind. I'm going to copy and paste this because I know I'm going to need that later. Now we want to get those resistors. Okay. I'm going to get a series load and see if that's the one I'm looking for. I just wanted to find, okay, so this load is defined as how many watts and stuff like that it consumes as a load. I just want the branch. We're going to take this RLC branch. If you double click on that model, double left click, you'll be able to define the inductances, the capacitance. Again, I just want a simple resistor. So we're going to say this is zero. And I'm going to make this resistance or impedance 20. And then I'm going to make sure that it knows that this is just a resistor. We say, okay, I got a simple resistor here. We're doing great. Okay. And you can also copy and paste this. And again, it'll name differently. And so just for the sake of being organized here, in the debugging process, whenever it says there's an issue somewhere or you have a problem with a component, if you label it, rather than just leaving the name, it'll say, hey, we have an issue at Z line, rather than we have an issue at resistor one, resistor two. It can be kind of annoying, difficult to narrow down where that is. So naming all your components is helpful. And I'm going to call this Z line and Z load. That's something I'm used to. Usually the load being the last thing and then the line being anywhere in between. And then you can also orient components how you like them. So you can go to rotate or flip. We're going to go clockwise or counterclockwise. I'm going to blow this up so it looks a little bit bigger. Hopefully that looks fine enough for everybody to see. Okay, great. So now I have the basic circuit. Now all we need is the breaker, the switch. So this is a three-phase breaker. I'm looking for a single phase. First option, okay. Great, okay. And then I need a constant. I need something, this is externally controlled. So I need something that tells the breaker to shut or open. And that's gonna be, our purposes, a constant. And so here's another example of what you can do. If you know what you're looking for and you're willing to try some stuff out, if it doesn't work, you can just search and it'll pull up constant for you. So that's kind of a faster way. I knew everything was in that library. So that's why I was picking from it. But generally I actually search most of my components. So we're gonna make this constant. Okay, awesome. So here's our system. Now, generally after we've made something like this, if I go back to my image, that's what it looks like. Everything looks good. We got the labels going on. You can change this breaker, but because we just have one, if I had more, otherwise I would change it. Initial status to one. So now I have a switch. This will be closed. We can simulate it. We can define the values. Peak amplitude is gonna be 100. Frequency is gonna be 60. And then I don't want this to be identical. We're gonna make this 5. So now I have a voltage divider. Now, if you don't know what that is, that's okay. It's not very important. The point is that we've made this simple circuit. We have two resistors here, a switch that opens, and that'll come into effect later when you see it, and a voltage source. Now, generally when we're making a simulation like this, we wanna measure stuff. We wanna take a look at things. The main way that we do that is through measurement tools or blocks and scopes. Scopes is how you visualize those. So again, I'm gonna go into my fundamental, we're gonna find specialized power systems. Within here, there's measurements. You can do the dropdown. And then I'm gonna scroll down and find voltage measurement. And I wanna measure, the voltage drop across this resistor. And again, for that, I'm gonna need a scope. Okay, so I'll pull the scope out. Okay, awesome. We've got our Simulink model, no problems here. So just like I was talking about earlier, the first step is making the Simulink model, then we're gonna need to package it. So let's see if it runs first. And this is something you want to do generally, you know, if you're doing a lot of coding anyway, but let's just run it and see if it works like we think it should. So I'm going to click run up here, and usually the debugger will tell me if it doesn't like something. Oh no, okay, so it's telling me here, I need the power GUI block. Anytime you use these Simscape power systems, you'll require the power GUI block. Now I know it says maybe some other issues. I'm going to take on the first one and see if we can solve that. So I'm just going to search power GUI. As you can see, I searched it previously. I'm going to pull out the power GUI. And having done this several times and just the simulations I'm used to running, we're going to go with discrete. And I usually start with a sample time of 50 microseconds. Let's save. And then we need to save this as a name. So I'm going to go under where I'd like to save this file. I'm going to go to my user account. And we're going to call this OPAL2Node. Okay. Now I'll try and run it. It's compiling down here in the bottom. 10 seconds. Okay, see, it did that really fast. That was it's not doing it real time. It's just computing it and spitting out as fast as it can. We're going to look at what the scope says here. Okay, the blob of yellow. But again, it's over the course of 10 seconds. Each of these is 60 hertz. And so in here, we can go through, if you wanted to look at those waveforms to see if anything was, you know, awry, you can zoom in and here we go. Okay, that's a little bit more digestible, still kind of crazy. You can look at, you know, let's look at half a second. Let's look at roughly a quarter of that or half of that. Okay, well, we should roughly have 7.5 waveforms, something of that order. And that's roughly what we have. And so, okay, this is acting like it should. It had the voltage dividing characteristics that we wanted earlier. Yeah, we have 80, which is what I would anticipate on the voltage division. Okay, so this is behaving as we would suspect and as we'd want. If we want to put this into OPAL, though, again, we've done the first step. We've made the simulation in MATLAB Simulink, but we want some real-time behavior. So now we need to package it up into this main computation system for OPAL-RT. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to highlight everything. Now, the reason why I'm not highlighting the power GUI is because the power GUI block, the way it operates is it has to be on the highest level of your model. And so I'm going to keep it at the highest level. So we're just going to highlight everything. We're going to right click. We're going to scroll down. We're going to go down to create subsystem from selection. And now we've created our subsystem. So this is that left side that we were working on. We're trying to package this. So we're going to rename this SM. And that stands for main computation system. And then we're going to give it the name as the file name in Simulink. So OPAL2Node is what I gave. Awesome. Okay. Now we need to make the CPU or SC system. And that's going to be what RT-LAB allows us to interact with while we're running our Simulink model on the OPAL. So I'm going to go to library browser. And just to start off with, we're going to just make another const, or we're going to make a input. And I'll explain for that later here in just a second. I'm going to have to make an output for this. See how there's no pieces where we can actually draw. There's no outputs that come from the system into the next block like we had here. I need to make these input outputs. So I'll come back to that here, but right now let's make this system. It's very simple. I'm making an input. Then I need something called an opcom block. This is something that OPAL-RT needs to recognize points between subsystems within your Simulink model. And so you'll need to do this anytime there's a signal typically coming into your system from another system. And so I'm designing this second subsystem such that signals come from the SM block into the SC block. And so when they enter, they're going to first have to come through the opcom block. And then anything through there is what we can look at, manipulate, stuff like that. So then I'm going to go to scope. I'm going to pull the scope out over here. Select that. And then this is all we're going to do. I just want to run this system and show that we can see it in the OPAL. So we're going to select that, right click again, and create subsystem. Now, because I made that input, like I should have made an output here, we have it can receive an input. So real quick, I'm going to delete this. And we need to make sure that before we do anything else, we name the system right. Otherwise, it won't separate properly and you'll get all these debug issues. So again, we're going to call this SC underscore OPAL2Node. Cool. And so we have an input now, but I need to make an output. So what do we want to look at? while we're looking at this, at measuring the voltage drop across here, and that's what we're doing in Simulink, we can keep everything we have here, but somehow I need to get it to the other one. I need to get it to the other system because that's what we're going to be able to see when RT-LAB runs. And again, that's the software that allows us to connect and talk with the OPAL-RT. So I'm going to say output. And you can rename the out. So if we wanted to, we could say voltage drop if we like here. I'm going to keep it as out for simplicity. And now I have an out. So now I can tie this. Okay, awesome. So we have the original model. We packaged it into a subsystem called SM. That's for main computational system. And then we made an output, read that output as an input for the computer system, the system we're going to see when we're running on the OPAL with RT-LAB software. And then this is what we're going to see. We need the OPCOM block to allow us to receive those inputs from our Simulink system. And that's an RT-LAB situation. Okay, so I've changed a little bit here, right? Let's make sure that it still runs in Simulink because Simulink's gonna help us out the most in the debugging process. If we have issues later on OPAL-RT, or it's gonna be much more difficult. It's not as, I would say, intuitive, and it's not as helpful in identifying what exactly your issue is. So let's run that here. Oh no, I have some more issues. What are we gonna do? Okay. So if we scroll down, it says there's an init function callback. I'll tackle that here in a little bit. But first, I want to look at this fixed step size. So there's a solver on here. Most of your issues are going to be solved by going to model settings. And this is going to be configuration parameters. And then we'd simply, it's asking us to change the from variable step to fixed step. And I know to go here because, again, if I just look through this, it'll say the solver is step to variable. To change this, go to simulation configure parameters. Okay. So if you reading this, we'll go to, okay, it wants fixed step. Now, I've done this a number of times. I typically start with Runga Kutta and go from there. Solver details, it says this is set to auto and it needs it set to something. I'm gonna make this the same as I did for the power GUI, and that's gonna be 50 microseconds. And we're gonna save that. Okay, now we're gonna try and run it. Now, I think I only solved one thing. Hey, but that seemed to solve the rest of the issues. So there was another issue there. But I just want to tackle one at a time because sometimes maybe if I change something, I change more than one thing, I did too much and maybe I was doing some damage. So I try and solve one issue at a time to get to the solution. And we ran it and there was no problem. And if I look at things, even though we haven't done anything with OPAL-RT yet, we've just used Simulink, you should still be able to see the waveforms. Still operating, we just used Simulink. We're going to open this up. Like I said, we can investigate. We're seeing the same thing we did on the Simulink side. Okay, cool. So now we have our finished Simulink model. We're gonna save this. I remember my name, OPAL-2 node, know where you saved it. Okay, I'm gonna minimize this, get out of the debug. We're gonna get rid of the Simulink library browser. And now we're gonna see if we can throw this on OPAL-RT. So what you wanna do is you wanna go over and download the software you're using. Again, we're using RT-LAB. There are other types of proprietary software like HyperSim. And HyperSim essentially does both of this for you. But because, again, a lot of our labs use MATLAB already and we're moving towards the direction of using OPAL-RT, Simulink just made sense. So now we're going to make, you want to make a workspace where you want to basically be saving all of this. I'm going to go to my account. That looks good to me. Okay, awesome. You're going to click OK, and it'll start up and get everything ready for you. So you'll get this first opening page. You can either go to here, up here in the top left, or just simply go to Workbench. Here you'll see a very blank. It's going to get a little bit complicated later. Up here, you'll see targets. These are simply what you're connected to. This is generally the network and then the target. The targets are just the machine that you're trying to interface with. And so target 137, you can double click it. And anything over here you double click, it'll actually open a window and tell you everything about that. And so we know the IP address. You can go into the specifics of what model it is, what platform it's running on, things of that nature. And so this is the OPAL 5700 that we'll be working on. Then next, the first thing I want to do is I want to create a new project. So we're going to double left click, create a new project. And generally, I'd keep this, you can make this whatever you like. Just for our sake, I'm going to call it OPAL practice. Doesn't have to be all caps. And just because of, I don't know if this is something for RT-LAB, but I generally don't do spaces, so we'll do OPAL_practice. I know where the location is to save. We're going to say next. I want it within the Simscape project space. We'll say finish. And now it's going to set up that project for us. Then we're going to go to the dropdown, and it needs models. We don't have any models for it right now. So we're going to right-click, go down to add existing model, and it's going to say, do you want to link to something or do you want to add it? We're going to import. So we need to browse and find our Simulink model to put into the RT-LAB software, operate on the OPAL-RT. So I'm going to go to my user account. And we made OPAL 2 node. That's what we were working on. And you can verify it. Yeah, okay. Now, what I suggest, you see we have a bunch of stuff here. And we see here's the PowerPoint I was showing you. Here's another model I made. I recommend whenever you're working on these things, make a separate folder. So actually, instead of putting it here, I would say make a new folder and put it in that folder, because it'll, every time you select the area you saved, it'll pull up everything. So just to simplify this, you can just say deselect all, and then we're gonna go find the system. So we're gonna go to OPAL 2 node, and then finish. And what we're going through now is now that one of those documents that was shown, a lot of this is covering that. Okay, so now we can verify, we have OPAL 2 node. It'll say it's not compiled though. And so that's the next step we'll have to go into. But right now we've essentially saved a copy of our Simulink model. So from here on out, you can actually edit the model with an OPAL-RT, and that's what we'll get into. I'll show you that here in a little bit once we run it once. But if you edit anything from OPAL-RT going into this model, so if we edit the model from OPAL-RT and it'll open up MATLAB for us, editing this file that we've essentially copied will not edit the original. Just keep that in mind when you're changing things, because sometimes you'll, this is good for debugging and you don't want to have to go through the process of reloading that file. So, we'll come back to that. There'll be a review. But so I've uploaded the Simulink model within RT-LAB, and it says it's not compiled yet. We've already set our target. That's one of the first things you want to do before you even make a project. Make sure that your target's assigned, it's up. That basically means the machine's up and running, and it's connected to the computer. Then we're going to see if it builds. Does it build? And this is just going to see if it can compile all the MATLAB code into some digestible C that can then be put on those FPGAs and the computers within OPAL-RT. And we'll just be using one core, if anybody's interested in that. And generally this, especially for simpler models like what we're doing, it should only take about a minute and a couple seconds. So bear with me. How am I doing? Is the pace good?
Pace is fine. Just a reminder, everybody, if you have questions, feel free to put them into the Q&A box. And Ms. Isis will direct him towards Rusty.
Now, the build is the area where there will be most of the issues or places where you'll run into things with OPAL-RT not agreeing with what you have. The first thing being, make sure that you have the target assigned and the compiler correctly and stuff like that. Every once in a while when it's doing this, when it's building, it'll give you these warnings. These are things that are actually pretty common, and you can search those on the OPAL-RT website, and they're very helpful in helping you identify how to fix those or what those mean. It's looking good so far. Just to note, okay, so see the compilation took a minute and a half. So we've now built the model, and now it says, okay, it's ready to be put on the target. So the next step after it's been compiled, let's load it onto the OPAL-RT, put it on the hardware. We're gonna load the node. And when it does this, it's gonna pull up that piece that we can interact with and look at. That was that right-hand side of this diagram I gave you. So we're gonna get that. But because this debugging, once you get here, is a little, can be kind of ugly, that's why you wanna make sure it works in Simulink first, then come to OPAL-RT, and then try and work that out. Great, okay, so it loaded, it completed. So now we're ready to execute. And we can see down here, it's actually, it's brought up that second system. So as we can see, everything basically to the left of the opcom block, which is all of our inputs, is gone. Everything, only the things we put on that right system, the SC system, is what I'm going to be able to see, interact with, et cetera. So I'm going to go to the scope. There's something that happens usually when you put in these scopes, you have to change the viewing options. So you want to go to view, configuration properties, logging, and then uncheck limit data points, unless you're worried about memory and stuff like that. But if you don't do this, it'll only let you see partial waveforms and things of that nature. So we're going to say, okay, great, looks good. I want this open so we can look at it in real time. We're going to run this for about 10 seconds. And all this should be doing is just running the system in real time as we're speaking now. So you can't click run here, that won't work. You want to say execute because we're actually trying to control the OPAL-RT, not Simulink. So click execute. And then I can jump to it. We can open up this. You can watch the scope, and there you go. It's happening in real time. Okay, cool. So that just shows you how we can run a simple system. I want to show you how we can interact with it in real time now. And you might be thinking, oh my gosh, we have to, you know, go through this whole process. Sorry, I'll get back to this in a second. What you want to do when you're done is you want to pause and then reset the model. Now, again, I want to edit this. I want to show you some different characteristics. You might be thinking, oh, this is going to be a nightmare. He's going to have to delete what we have here. He's going to have to go back to MATLAB, edit it, re-upload. You don't have to go through that. They have this nice, you can edit the model within RT-LAB. So I'm going to click on edit. Now, as I said earlier, when we edit the model within RT-LAB, we're editing the copy that we upload. So it'll pull up another MATLAB account or file. And here's the copy that we've uploaded to RT. Now I want to edit this a little bit. I want to get, what we're going to show you is I want to see if I can get this control loop going on. So I can interact with the real-time simulation while it's running. So we're going to right-click on SC, and I want to change this up a little bit. We're going to go to the library browser. And sometimes this will take a little bit. I've noticed that once you open it from OPAL-RT, some things are a little bit slower. But it'll get there. It should be about a minute, maybe less. Okay, so we have it pulled up here, and I'm gonna get the constant out. And see, even searching takes a little bit of time. Constant will also be found in commonly used blocks. Don't be alarmed at the change in lighting. Okay, commonly used blocks. Oh, I didn't spell it right. Okay, if you don't spell it right, that'll be an issue. I'll bring constant here, and then I want to have an output. Here's our drag and drop output. And then when I get out of this, I have an output. Well, now I need an input for SM, for the full system. And what I want to show is we want to actually manipulate this switch while it's running. So this whole time it was set to a constant one, meaning it was closed the entire time. You didn't see any interruptions in the waveform. I'm going to get rid of this, and we're going to make this our input. Now, as I said earlier, whenever you have an input and you're interacting from one subsystem to another, as we are here going from SC back to SM, just like we did when we were going from SM to SC, we need one of those opcom blocks. So I'm going to go here, and we're just going to search opcom. And this will be in your RT-LAB library if you're looking for it. Pull it out. Great. Okay, cool. So now all I've done is I set up an output from the SC to have an input to the SM, and we used opcom blocks to interpret those inputs. And so now when this value is one, which it begins to, which it starts as in the beginning, it'll be closed. And when this is zero, this will open the switch and we shouldn't have any signal going. So now I'm going to save this. And again, everything I just changed, because I edited it within the debug capabilities of RT-LAB, I didn't actually change the original file. I can actually go back to the original file that we had earlier, and there's been no change. So this is a good way to change things with your model, see how it would work, and see how you can make it, but they won't be permanent changes per se. So then we're going to come out of this. Okay, awesome. I've saved it already. We're going to minimize, get rid of this. Okay, so I went to edit. I've already got, we were editing an already imported model. So now we're going to try and build it. We're going to see if there's any issues with that. And see, if you try and build the model you've already built, it'll let you know, it should like instantaneously build, because it'll say there was no change. It identified that we changed the model within what we uploaded to RT-LAB, and so that's why it says, oh, we need to go through this process again. Oftentimes it'll verify you're using the right type of MATLAB version, and that's all associated with what you've purchased with OPAL-RT. And see, like I said earlier, it'll open this up. And it specifically looks for SM and SC and then file name. So just again, that's important to do. Great, okay. So that took a little bit longer. Or I guess this one was shorter. Usually it takes, in the time practice runs I've done, it'll take a minute five, this is a minute of seven, that was minute nine. Great, so we built it, now we can load it. So now it says, hey, your changes were valid, and see all those changes we made are can be seen here. But again, within OPAL-RT, what it opens up for you to be able to interact with is only the desktop CPU visible interactive version, which is this SC portion. So it opens this for us. I'm gonna go into that scope. And you can actually save these changes, but I just want to show it so you remember. You go to View, Configuration Properties, Logging, and then you unclick or uncheck Limit Data Points to 5,000. So we can see the whole waveform. Sometimes before you run, you want to click this. It'll auto-scale. I can already see that we have the max axes that we need, and it's going to go from 0 to 10 seconds, so we'll be okay. Okay, now we're ready to run. So I'm going to execute the model. And while it's changing, I'm going to press zero here for a little bit, and then I'm going to change it to one. And you might be thinking, well, why'd you change it from zero to one or whatever? So I ran that. In real time, we could have seen those changes, but I'll show you what that came out in the scope. We have this here. So it ran, and in the beginning, for the first almost 6 seconds, we had that constant value was set to one. So the switch was closed, and we had a full completed circuit at, you know, T equals 5.9 roughly, I changed that constant value to zero, which opened the switch and gave us no voltage reading. Then at roughly 9 seconds, I made that value one again and it flipped on that switch. So just as you can see, we can not only interact with real-time software simulations that are running on the OPAL, but in doing so, you can also integrate hardware in the loop signals where both digital and analog inputs and outputs can be sent to hardware that can be integrated into these simulations, that those too can affect the simulation just as we did here with software in real time. So there you go. I close that. Once you've ran something, it's still technically running on the OPAL. You want to pause. So even though we said just execute for 10 seconds, it's still on the OPAL-RT. So we need to pause the model on the OPAL-RT, and then we need to reset. And then from here, we can go in, we can build, we can add, we can do all these different types of things to this model. So this is an example of how you can make a very simple Simulink model. Here's the original. Here's the version I changed in OPAL-RT. These are the inputs, necessary blocks that you need to communicate with, and general architecture that can allow you to make systems like I showed here, and more complex ones like you see in these images or in the routes demonstrated ahead. So that's all I have for the presentation. I hope everybody liked it. If anybody's got any questions, I'm happy to answer those. Hopefully that was a good dry run, a good introduction to it.
Rusty, we currently do not have any questions from the attendees.
Cool.
But I have a question. Until we get questions from anyone, how have you been using this software specifically? What have you been building and simulating? Can you tell us a little bit about that? Or not?
Was just
there, Rusty?
Yeah, can you hear me?
There we go.
Oh,
we can
sorry.
Hear you now.
Okay, sorry about that. I guess it just let me know my internet connection is unstable. Yeah, there was a project I worked on last year that was a collaboration with the national labs, Idaho National Labs, Sandia, and whatnot. And we were working on a microgrid study up in Cordova, Alaska. And so my objective or job was to take that and make it so that we could, in the future, work on it and simulate and compare it with other microgrid studies that we might have here at NMSU. And so my job was to basically make the entire model in Simulink. So it was much more complex than this. There was lots of these blocks, many pieces. And so I've been through the ringer of trying to model and simulate and debug, not just, 10 blocks or so, but at least a couple hundred. And that's why I can understand the process of fixing it in Simulink first, then going on OPAL-RT. But it got to a point where, OPAL-RT has the computational capabilities of not only doing it in real time, but simply conducting it. Sometimes you'll have a model that's so big and so complex that running it on MATLAB Simulink just becomes, I wouldn't say not feasible, but a very lengthy, time-consuming process. And I'm experiencing some of that on my thesis, but we took that model and we could break it down, we could compile it, and then we could run all of that whole simulation of that microgrid in OPAL-RT and look at some of those waveforms, look at faults that would take place or issues, disturbances on the grid. And with that, we could, compare those outcomes to other simulation software. And the future prospects of this is to be able to use this with other New Mexico State studies that we'd like to have with rooftop solar data and real-time data that you can essentially plug in, whether that's from, a spreadsheet, just like you normally would with any other code, or it's actually, as we're speaking, the data we're getting off of the electricity being consumed on the roof or produced.
Awesome. Wow. Okay. So you can do a lot with this system, and it sounds pretty essential to anyone who's pursuing a career in power systems or microgrids in general, smart grids.
Definitely. Yeah. It's a growing, very fast adoption right now. Popular simulation softwares like PSLF and ETAP are all big. And actually a lot of those you can use with the other software types aforementioned. So not HyperSim, we're using EmegaSim, but PhaserSim and FPGAsim use other types of software. And some of them are just you could just simply code something and it'll speed it up. These are mostly for power electronics and smaller applications. And so they use other things. We're using Simulink and RT-LAB. HyperSim uses HyperSim. Some of these, like I said, they're specifically made for other types of software suites. And so it's not just like you're restricted to this. And it really opens up that the conversation about trying to legitimately and credibly simulate something before you put it in the real world. I mean, it can be costly to get some of this equipment, but I think there's definitely an investment made by research associates and industry to make sure that before they put something out there, they've got at least even some hardware input as part of those simulations.
Sweet. Oh, this is cool. We don't have any questions yet, but I do have to say this was very well presented and it's a lot less scary than other presentations I've seen. So thank you for making this very simple and not intimidating.
Totally.
Software. Done a great job.
Brittany, I have a question. Rusty, is this open source or is it license based? How do you get access to it?
Access to like the hardware or any of it? So MATLAB, you'll have to get the license, of course, and Simulink should come with that. That's what some of the packages you can download. But anybody who's in the research consortium being part of, you know, any of the labs or being part of any of the universities should have an academic and research license for that. And once you have that, you can at least use eMegaSim. To my knowledge, you have to make an account, and there, depending on your work, you can get HyperSim. So it's all, anything outside of that, RT Lab is owned by OPAL-RT, but usually any of eMegaSim and HyperSim, some of those you have to purchase. It just depends on what the nature of your work is, similar to like if you're working with MATLAB, but usually that just starts with making an account and reaching out to them. But you tend to have to pay for all of those. RT Lab is the cheaper one, because basically once you've bought the license you've bought the hardware for OPAL-RT. So we've purchased the OPAL-RT machine. That's the biggest expense. Then getting the license to run on it, for you to work on it. And buying that license essentially allows you to work with certain MATLAB packages and whatnot. Once you've done that, you just have to have MATLAB, and then they'll give you RT Lab to integrate that with. So there's some things you have to purchase, like the hardware. So, and any inverters that OPAL-RT makes, they have some power electronics you can purchase that can serve as interfaces. But you know, we have some stuff in the lab. We have several relays that I was working on last semester where, you know, I broke open the relay, found where there's inputs and outputs, took those wires and make sure I scaled them down so that they didn't hurt the computer or the other way around. And so you can, so long as you have hardware that you want to work with and you have MATLAB, you can do at least what we did with RT Lab, so long as you purchase the equipment essentially. And the license is kind of integrated with that equipment purchase. So I'd say the biggest barrier to entry is the hardware. But once you have that, at least so far as Simulink, that's kind of the most costly thing. I can't say much about ePhaser Sim, FPGA Sim, or HyperSim because I haven't used them. I've seen HyperSim, but yeah, those tend to be, you have to pay for most of that from OPAL-RT. And that's been taken care of through our lab with Dr. Laprova.
Okay, thanks.
Sure.
And I know we have actually supported you guys getting that equipment down there. So it's great. Our New Mexico Smart Grid Center has, and I know there's also some support for the test site at Mesa del Sol as well. So it's great to hear that it's being used and that you're training our students on this so they can use it.
Totally.
We have a question from our own Selena Keneally. She asks, do you ever hook more than one OPAL-RT up together? How big is this thing?
I suppose you can. There's actually two network ports on the back, so I wish I could show you, but you see this image on the right, you can, if you turn that around, there's two Ethernet cables in the back, and so I haven't looked at it, but you could have one pretend to be something and the other one pretend to be something else, because essentially, they can, first of all, I guess, connect to each other on the network, or you could just have digital inputs and outputs feeding out of one and into another, and the other one can pretend to be something else. You can also take, like I said, you could record data from different machines, install all of, or read all of those into the OPAL, and it's pure job, I guess you could make. And in theory, I'm just coming up with this, you know, if I was making an experiment like this, you could just say, okay, this OPAL's whole job is to just pretend to be these types of machines. And then you could feed all of that input into the other OPAL. And that's like, if you were doing something very highly complex. It can also be a really good asset for cybersecurity research. That's what I've looked at with a couple other, some other documentation associated with Sandia, some other projects they did, where it serves as like a communication hub and for those types of simulations where you can read in all of those signals and you can have it simulate a cyber attack environment type of thing. And that's the direction we're in some ways moving towards with New Mexico State and Southwest TDI, otherwise known as the IDEAL research area. It's another part here on campus, is that, you know, the nice part about OPAL-RT is it's almost like a really good conglomerate, a way to integrate and pull together all of the data in a system. So we're interested in looking at, we have several buildings over there. You could pull together all the data being read into this machine. And you can simulate it on there, and then you can build all this other infrastructure that you otherwise wouldn't be able to afford. You know, I can't walk out tomorrow and just go build a distribution system, but I can if I have OPAL-RT. I can just build that, and then we can just take all these components we already own. So we have a relay, we have a solar panel on the roof, and we have an electric car. Well, if you have OPAL, you can build a fake model of your distribution feeder, and then you can pull that all together. You don't have to go test it outside. And then that would allow for, in the future, if you wanted to design something, you could try and design it using OPAL as like a test bed. And then if it works, then you can move on to the actual grid. So it's like, it's a really good midway between theoretical and application, because you can plug in and aggregate actual real-time hardware inputs from around, you know, your research environment.
Okay, that is cool.
So long answer, yes, you could connect them, but I guess there's a number of ways you could do that.
Awesome. So I'm going to say last chance for questions all. Well, we've got Dr. Rusty in the house. and if I don't hear anything, I will just end this early. But we did want to give you a chance, because Rusty is really good at answering questions and making this accessible. So while we're waiting for any other questions to come in, I'm going to just take a moment to say thank you again to Rusty for doing this at the end of the semester when it's a really busy time. I also want to thank my partner in crime, Isis Cerna, who's been making everything go smoothly behind the scenes. And we don't have a webinar for next month public yet, so stay tuned. We may be taking a hiatus over the summer, but stay tuned to our website, our newsletter, and our social media feeds to see if that changes. And it looks like without that, we have no more questions. So, I mean, thanks so much, Rusty, for doing this. And for everybody who's...
Yeah, thanks, Rusty.
Everyone who's listening.
Good job.
We will be, we're recording this and it will be up on our YouTube channel. We'll send you an email in a little while, like in about a week, to let you know when it's up so you can refer to it later. With that, have a wonderful day, everybody.
Thanks, everyone.